listen to right before the Alleluia. This feast, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, is one of the few feasts that still has what we call a sequence. States for us, just in case we're not aware, Jesus is the Paschal victim. Jesus is alive, and through him, because of resurrection, we are meant to have life. That's the focal point of this Easter Sunday. Not the fact that if you haven't done it already, when you go home, you're going to go to the dining room table where the basket is, and you're going to put your hand in and enjoy a jelly bean, perhaps, or one of those Cadbury eggs, which are nice and sweet. Or perhaps if you live in a place which is a little bit larger, you can go out on the fire escape. Stroke your pet rabbit, which is also connected with this feast. See, there's a lot of accidentals, but we're never meant to overlook the core. The Father never stopped loving us. And because he loves us, sent the Son to show us how we are to live. We repeat this feast each year around this time after we have the first full moon of spring. It is time of renewal. It is meant to be a time of rejuvenation. A time of reconnecting with God, who in sending his Son presented to us an example of how to deal with those things in our lives that brings us suffering and discontent, so that we do not at any particular point become a group of people, men and women, who lose a sense of hope. If our faith is truly alive, we always have hope. In the words of the late Pope John Paul II, be not afraid. Be not afraid of who and what you are, in the sense of your belief, your allegiance to a local church community, and to the worldwide church, including Pope Benedict XVI, who next Sunday, as we celebrate also Divine Mercy Sunday, will beatify Pope John Paul II. Beatification is not meant to indicate that John Paul did it correctly, but he was able to inspire many of us not to be afraid, but to be men and women of deepening faith. And when you consider the world around us, which is more than a little bit, you know, off kilter, we need more faith. We need the Ten Commandments. We need the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Yes, we need love, but God's definition of love. By no means plans did the Father ever have initially with what we call romantic love? That's usually our problem. Because sometimes we can misinterpret. We can have a miscommunication. Sometimes we assume, which we never should, but we do. And we lose out. This feast, which presents to each and every person of goodwill the invitation to life everlasting. Now we can be a little frivolous about this and say, well, really, what's life everlasting? Is that a place where I can go and I can have as many Cadbury eggs as I want and there's no calories? Understand that love, if we crave that love, if we really yearn for that love, then it will mean more to us. It, meaning everlasting life, will mean more to us than less calories. No blood pressure medication. Not those things that disturb us at 2:30 in the morning, but rather we yearn for God's presence with us now. That's the beginning of everlasting life, this side of the tomb. I used to live with a friar who would greet us each morning and say, "Hey guys, how you doing? It's a great day. Every day above ground is great." They say he was a character, to say, I put that mildly. But Joe was right. Every day above ground is great. Especially as we dedicate to God the Father. Especially as we give thanks to the Son, who did not just talk the talk, but he walked the walk. He is real. He is alive. How real and how alive are we? As the 6 weeks of Lent help us to get beyond our pettiness, or are we still lagging a little bit? Then we're doubly blessed because we had 6 weeks of Lent, but we have 8 weeks to celebrate Easter. 8 weeks to know this through our hearts and souls again and again, so that we believe deeply, yes, we belong to God. Because he loves, he saves, he brings us hope and his peace. May God be with you.